Welcome back. In this tutorial, we are going to build upon the idea of having a distribution that we talked about in the tutorial on maximum likelihood estimation. That is part 2. But before that, here is a quick recap. In the part 1, we went through the process of building a linear model using polynomials of various degrees. We learned about sum of squared error function and saw the solution to get the weight vector. We also noticed that a more capable polynomial of higher degree overfitted. We then discussed two remedies. The first one was to use a bigger data set, and the other was to do regularization. In the second part, we went over the benefits of taking probability first view of modeling. And unlike the explanations in part 1, this view of modeling not only helped us to get a predictive distribution of the target variables, but we also saw that some squared error function emerged naturally when we assumed the error or noise to be Gaussian. As such, we did mention the question of how we can be sure about the parameters of the distribution, that is the weight vector and the precision beta vector. And today, we are going to spend some time trying to sort all this out. So, our situation is that we have started to see that the target variables as random variables. But our weights or weight vector and even beta parameter are still point estimates. And very much like in part 2, one way to have a confidence about these unknowns is to treat them as random variables. This way, we can have a probability distribution associated with various values our unknown parameters can take. Here is the analytical solution for the weight vector that we had obtained using maximum likelihood estimation, which is, as you should know by now, is same as the one that you would get by using sum of squared as error function. Now, looking at this solution, it should be clear that the determination of weights depend on independent variables and the target variables. And in order to express the same relationship using the language of probability, we would end up formulating a conditional probability distribution of weight vector. That is, we seek what is the conditional probability distribution of W given X and T. Quite many times we just end up saying probability of W given X and T. So the new goal here is to determine the parameters of this conditional probability distribution. And for that, we will have to take the help of Bayes' rule. There is a good chance you know all this already, but a quick reminder never hurts. Bayes' rule or Bayes' theorem in its original form is applied on events where one can get the probability of one event given another. Here, A and B are placeholders that can be either events or random variables. So the rule can be applied on probability distributions as well, essentially, because A and B could be random variables and a random variable has a distribution. And in that case, the denominator will be called the normalizing constant. As such, it is known by various names and we will give it a visit again in next few tutorials. But for now, just thinking of it as a constant that is required to normalize the numerator is good enough, because it makes a valid probability distribution. A valid probability distribution is the one that integrates to 1, and hence we have to do a normalization. And more importantly, since it is a constant, we can also say that the conditional distribution of B given A is proportional to the numerator. By the way, components of numerator in Bayes' rule when applied on random variables get some specific terminology. The distribution of B is called prior. This is essentially your belief in B before you see any data. You can either use your domain knowledge of B to specify it or use the data to figure it out. This B generally represents unknown parameters, as you will see soon. The distribution of A given B is called likelihood. It mostly represents your data. And finally, the resulting conditional distribution of B given A is called posterior. With this quick overview of Bayes' rule out of the way, we can see the conditional distribution of weight vector given x and t as the posterior. And it is proportional to the product of likelihood and prior on w. That said, our first order of business here now is to express what we believe this prior is. For now, I'm going to assume that the prior distribution is a normal distribution that has a mean of 0 and has a diagonal covariance matrix. Okay, let's take a step back, as you may or may not be familiar with covariance matrix. Essentially, the assumption on prior is that each of the weight variables are following Gaussian distribution with a mean of 0 and a precision of alpha. They all have the same precision parameter, and another assumption is that they are independent of each other. That is, they do not influence each other. As such, the notation you see for the distribution of W here is for the multivariate normal distribution, where the variance or the precision has been replaced with a covariance matrix. Since we have assumed independence, we can write it as a scaled identity matrix. I am assuming you know what an identity matrix is. And this is why I also use the word diagonal covariance matrix, as entries off the diagonal are zeros, indicating that there is no correlation between the various weight variables. Now, we will make one modification to our notation as well. Here, see that I am now seeing the prior as a conditional distribution. It is conditioned on the alpha. What is important to note here is that the alpha is a hyperparameter. It is a scalar value. It is not a random variable, at least not so far. Unfortunately, there is no consistency around the notation. You may think that when you condition on, it should always be a random variable that you should condition on. But here it is not the case. So it is likely that in other books or articles, you may not see this notation, where W is conditioned on alpha. Rather, most of the time it is implied. Similarly, the posterior notation can be extended to include both alpha and beta parameters. Now that we have a distribution of weights that we obtain, or at least we have a formulation of using the likelihood and the prior, the next question is, what value of W should we use to make the prediction? You see, posterior is a distribution of W, and you have to pick a value of W in order to make a prediction. And at least for the purpose of this tutorial, one answer for this thought is to choose the most probable value. That is, the state of W that has the highest probability of happening. So then we ought to find this most probable value. And since weights follow a Gaussian distribution, it's an inherited assumption, because you see, our likelihood is Gaussian and our prior is Gaussian, and we know that a product of two Gaussian functions is again a Gaussian function. This is why I am saying that the posterior will be Gaussian. And this is also true. I really meant to say this. The reason I said a Gaussian distribution I apologize because I cannot plot a multidimensional function for you. But I hope you can see that we are after finding the peak of this Gaussian distribution, or rather a multivariate Gaussian distribution with a diagonal covariance matrix, since the peak represents the mode. And we can get the peak by using the optimization procedure. Essentially, we are going to turn this quest of finding the peak as a maximization problem. In simple steps, it translates into taking the negative log of posterior and then simply minimizing it. We did this kind of a stuff in maximum likelihood estimation as well. I hope you recall why we take a log and why we take a negative of a log. So this way we can turn it into a minimization problem. Essentially, after taking the negative log, you would be looking at finding the minima of following function. And our old friend is here too, the sum squared error function. The second term also, by the way, looks awfully familiar. Where have we seen this one? Remember part one, when we tamed overfitting by adding the extra term as the regularizer? Yes, this was ridge regression. But in part one, this term did not naturally arose as it has now. By the way, W transpose W is equal to W square. So there is it's just a notational difference. It's the same thing. It's going to give you the same value at the end of the day. And yes, ridge regression and map estimate are equivalent. By the way, map means maximum a posteriori. It's a French phrase meaning maximum of posterior. And lambda is nothing but a precision of prior divided by the precision of our target random variables. It still is a hyperparameter, as alpha is something you would pick based on your domain knowledge or based on data. We will talk about such things in next few tutorials. We are almost done with this tutorial, but there is one more interesting thing that I want to show you. So far, we have assumed that the likelihood and the prior are both Gaussian. However, if we were to assume that prior is uniform, then the map will be equal to maximum likelihood estimation. Uniform prior means that all values of W are equally likely. Well, within the interval range that you would use for your uniform distribution. Let me prove it to you as well. If our prior is uniform, when we take the log, it would simplify to some of these terms. Multiplication is getting changed into addition. Now we are saying that this is a PDF of a uniform distribution. And we know that the PDF of uniform distribution is a constant. So which means that this is equal to taking a log of a constant. And when we will do the maximization or minimization of the negative log, this second term will go away. And you can see that we will have the same solution as we had for the maximum likelihood estimation. And this is the reason I said map will be equal to MLE if your assumption on prior is that of a uniform distribution. And this brings us to the end of our tutorial. We have started to see our unknowns as random variables, both target variables and the weight variable. And I must say that it's a huge step towards Bayesian regression. However, there are still many things remaining to do to have a proper Bayesian inference. And that would be the topic of next tutorial in this series. I hope this was helpful. Let me know if you have a feedback and questions in the comments. I thank you for the precious time that you gave here. Have a good day. Bye for now. Bye-bye.